opening up somewhere around where we were last week. I read some of this last week, but I want to make a couple other points from this. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, the first 8 verses, Paul instructs them about avoiding certain sexual relations. Prenuptial unchastity was a matter of indifference in this society. Go ahead. It's up to you. At least for men, marital infidelity was the norm. In fact, some pagan religions. So again, men, he's a man. Peter Jones, a society in which sexual relations with a woman was not necessarily regarded as anything other than a means of procreation or purely physical satisfaction. The latter was widely available through prostitutes and slaves. Oh, he's got a prostitute or a slave. Chastity was regarded as an unreasonable restriction. What? You mean I can't? And Paul walks in here, struts in there, and says, yes, you can't. You may not. You may not do that. And they look at him and say, we've never heard of such a thing. That's odd. You're a weirdo, Paul. The same with working with your hands. You remember in verse 10, we urge the brethren to excel still more. Verse 11, make it your ambition to lead a quiet life, to attend to your own business, and to work with your hands. Again, a Greek defined wealth as the condition in which he could live without working, and poverty is the condition in which he had to live by working. So who wants to be thought of as poor? Nobody does. So if you don't want to be thought of as poor, you don't work with your hands. Paul says, work with your hands. But everybody will think I'm poor. Greeks despised manual labor. That's what slaves were for. And Paul says, no, you're to do it. Greeks and ambition. For the Greek, let your ambition be first. For a Greek, this is Demosthenes. Let it be your ambition to be first in everything. Remember we read that quote, be first, beat everybody. That's your life's goal, is to be first. I mentioned this had to do with the creation of the Olympics. Paul says, make it your ambition to have no ambition. Sproul says, the Greek word for this term often denoted the attempt to garner civic honor and recognition through outward displays of generosity by the wealthy. You'd go to a funeral, and whoever had the biggest bouquet of flowers was the wealthiest. And they'd have a competition. Even, in fact, it got so bad that one of them, Solon, outlawed it. He said, no more lavish displays of your wealth at funerals. Sounds crazy to us, but that's what they would do. This also led to the Olympics. I'm the best, and I'm going to prove it to you. Paul's use of the term turns it on its head. The Thessalonians should be zealous for the honor that comes not through self-assertion or an ostentatious show of personal greatness, but through humble, industrious, unimpeachable honor. Again, Paul walks into this culture and says, you guys have got it all wrong. You've got to do the other thing around. And they were doing it. The Christians were doing it. Finally then, brethren, chapter 4, verse 1, we request and exhort you in the Lord Jesus, as you received instruction from us as to how you ought to walk and please God, just as you actually do walk. And then he goes on to talk to him about these sexual relations. Don't do it. Look, you're doing it. At least to some degree, they are doing it, which means they looked like weirdos. Couple things from this. Number one, get ready to look like a weirdo. Accept it. It'll be worth it. While we're looking like a weirdo, turn to Ephesians chapter 5. Therefore, be imitators. Verse 1. Be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love just as Christ also loved you and gave himself up for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God as a fragrant aroma. But immorality or any impurity or greed must not even be named among you. This is the same message that he's writing to the Thessalonians. As is proper among saints, and there must be no filthiness and silly talk or coarse jesting, which are not fitting, but rather giving of thanks. Look at this, no filthiness, no silly talk or coarse jesting. Today I pick on Toby first. Toby, you've been around the guys down there or overseas or wherever, and they let loose with at least one crass joke. And you snicker with them. I'll pick on me now. I've been there. And I walk away and say, didn't do that one right. Fail. And God will say, that's exactly right, Lee. Look at this. Look at these Christians here in Thessalonica. This wasn't a joke for them. They were being persecuted because of what they had chosen to do. And Lee, you can't even not snicker when they make a joke that you shouldn't even be listening to. Verse 11, do not, Ephesians 5:11, do not participate in fruitful deeds. Instead, even expose them. I fell on two accounts. Not only did I not participate, but I also did not expose it. Guys, that's just off color. And God will always be able to point at these Christians and say, they had radical change. They looked like crazy people in the society, yet they stuck to it. Comments or questions on this? I don't know what that noise was. Couple more thoughts. Verse 9 in 1 Thessalonians 4:9. As to the love of the brethren, remember this is our term, Philadelphia. That's where we live, so we better be doing very well at this, and you too while you're up here, because we're in Philadelphia. Now as to the love of the brethren, remember this, you have no need for anyone to write you, for you yourselves are taught by God to love one another. You are taught by God. This word is an interesting word. You're God taught. Well, there you go. The English Standard Version Study Bible has this comment on this verse. Read it carefully. Jeremiah 31, 33 through 34, which the author of Hebrews quotes in chapter 8, says, we're in it, prophesied that God would write his law on the hearts of his people and directly teach them as part of the new covenant. What's the key word in there?
Directly.
First of all, did God say in Jeremiah 31, 33 that he would write his law on their hearts?
Yes.
Did he?
No, Jeremiah said.
Yeah. Did God do it? Did God write his law on your heart? Ethan, did you feel anything strange lately? Anyone?
Besides Harper.
That's what would happen, right? Did God write? Did he literally write on your heart? No, he did not literally. First of all, the language is figurative, and the question becomes, okay, he does write his law on your heart, but how? And what does he do when he says directly? First of all, God might directly write it on your heart. He assumes. God might. He assumes. It doesn't say it there. And last week, or the few weeks ago, we went through this little flow chart. Here's how the word works. It comes from the Father, goes through the Son, goes through the Holy Spirit. The apostles and prophets get it from the Holy Spirit, and they bring it to the Christians in Thessalonica. Turn to 2 Thessalonians 2. 2 Thessalonians 2, verse 14. It was for this he called you. How did he call them? Through our gospel, that you may gain the glory of our Lord Jesus. So he sends out the apostles and they teach, and some people reply to it, respond to it, and that's how they're taught. Verse 15, so then, brethren, stand firm and hold to the traditions which you were taught. Now, let me ask you this. Were they taught by God? Yes. But listen to what it says. Whether by word of mouth or by letter from us. That's how God teaches. So, and by the way, if God taught us directly, then do we have to have this class? No. I have one last thought before opening it up. The word brotherly love in verse 9. Now as to the love of the brethren. One man writes, brotherly love is not sufficiently considered by most Christian people. Christians. Who, if they looked into the matter, might find that few of their strongest affections were determined by the common faith. What this is saying is, We all have close affections. Who ought to be our closest people as Christians? As Christians, who ought to be our closest people? Each other. He is saying too often, that's not the case with Christians. No, this Christian has somebody that they're closest with who is not of the common faith. And I'm not saying that we never have good friends that are not Christian. I'm not saying that. I'm saying the rule is, here we are, common faith, and this is the way we ought to be. And some people end up, you know, I barely know my brethren. My friends are over here. And they've got it flipped upside down. Okay, I am ready to move into the next section. Is anybody want to say anything about this, the first 12 verses? Okay. Chapter 4, verse 13. Informing about those previously dead in Christ. Totally new section, totally new thought. But, or and, or now, it's the same word in verse 9. It'll be the same word in chapter 5, verse 1. But, we do not want you to be uninformed, brethren, about those who are asleep. That's a euphemism for dead. People who are dead. So that you will not grieve as do the rest who have no hope. I noticed this about these Christians. They were concerned for more than just themselves. Wait a minute. Another Christian has died. Fred died the other day. That's nice. What are we having for lunch?
Food.
So my father, as a carpenter, was working down in Morris, New York on Mr. Gould's house. And Mr. Gould wanted a cast iron tub moved from one room to the other. Nobody else was there to help, so my dad and Mr. Gould started carrying the cast iron tub. Anybody who's ever lifted up a cast iron tub, you know it's no light thing. Mr. Gould, who was not weak, dropped it and smashed his toe to smithereens. He goes to the hospital. Chris Gould, affectionately or not so called Ogre, who was slightly portly, came home from school, and when his sister told him Dad's toe is smashed, he's in the hospital and Mom's with him, Chris said, "What are we going to eat?" These people, somebody's dying somewhere and they are grieving. Wait, wait, wait. What's going to happen? Now they're confused, but they care. I'm sorry. Who? Oh, Gary.
I've run into it in talking with people where this, the same power falls into play in a negative sense, where you're studying with somebody and relative that they've just lost, that died in their sins. They're like, "Well, I can't accept this or believe this or follow this, because to do so I would have to acknowledge that my dearly beloved that's just passed away is in torment, and I can't accept that." Mm. So then they in turn reject the truth also.
Yeah. Now let me ask you, I'm glad you brought that up, because I was going to bring it up myself. Let me ask you this. Should we grieve when somebody who is an unbeliever, who has never submitted to Christ, dies? Yes. But do you know who in one way is okay with that? God himself. Now, God sent his son to die on the cross for everybody. But of those who will not accept him, he says, "Okay. If that's the way you want it, I don't like it."
He says he has no pleasure.
He has no pleasure in it. But he's not going to stop them. You could say it this way. He moves on. You know who else has to also? We do. Yes, we grieve. And that's what motivates us. Hey, you're going to die in your sins. Okay, you reject it? I cried. Paul would give himself up for his brethren. But we have to accept it also and say, okay, I'm not going to let it stop me. I'm going to get over this and I'm going to move on.
No. While the person is still alive, as you were saying, God sort of moves on when they reject him. But in the same token, when they're ready, if they decide that they're ready to come to him, he comes back. It's not like it's a limited time offer. Sort of
right.
Thing.
Limited time, unlimited while you're alive.
Right. Yeah.
Which implies, yes.
My response to those people is taking them to the rich man and Lazarus. Mm. And the rich man, he was in the place of torment, but he didn't want his relatives to come there. He wanted somebody to send help or word
right.
to them that they could avoid that place.
Right. That, what would they say if they could, right? And by the way, Gary, when he said that, probably wasn't thinking I was going to respond the way I did. I was taking it from our perspective. How, you know, what do we do? You know, yes, we compare, we are compassionate, we feel sorry for them, but don't let us drag us down. And Gary's point is, and now, to help that person who is refusing because they're and you know what I also say? God will judge. God will judge rightly. He will judge rightly. My mom said, my uncle committed suicide. And my mom, I remember, her attitude was, God will judge rightly. Nothing has left more impact than that. God will judge rightly. Yeah, that's right. Now, getting them to understand that.
We have to love God more than our
right.
family also.
Have to love God more than our family. Somebody else had a hand up or not. I guess not. Okay. Oh, did you notice here? I got this up here. The knowledge is the power. We have an expression, knowledge is power, right? Knowledge is power. We do not want you to be agnostics. In this specific, without the New King James, I believe, or the King James has ignorant. That's like agnostic. You can hear ignorant, agnostic. It's without knowledge. We don't want you to be without knowledge. And here's the result. So that. This is the result. When God gives you knowledge, the result will be, for those who meet the knowledge in faith, you will not grieve. Anybody grieving? I'm not going to apply this to more than grieving, depressed, discouraged, sad, you know, whatever you want. You plug it in there. What is the answer? Right here.
Knowledge.
The knowledge. In fact, are you sad? What does Romans 15:4 say? Whatever was written in earlier times was written for our instruction, so that through perseverance and the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. Feeling bad? Feeling down? Here's your prescription. Old and New Testament. Open it up and read it. And you know, you can find those who are of faith who cannot wait. They get excited when they're studying something, even if they don't like it. They're like, look what I figured out again today. Those kind of people will come to this word, and that is the preventative maintenance too. Yes, they'll get sad. Yes, there will be downs, ups and downs. Yes, all the time. But they are not characterized by grief because they have this word always in them. Comments? Questions? So, verse 14. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and the construction is, and we do believe, In the original language, yours says since.
Since, yeah.
Since we believe. That's more accurate. Although mine is, yours is getting the thought, mine is getting the word. But that's the idea. Because we believe, Jesus died and rose again. Even so, and I'm going to insert here, what's the even so? We also believe, if we believe he died, we also believe God will bring those, bring with him those who have fallen asleep in Jesus. The ESV will read this a little differently. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring him with him those who have fallen asleep. This with Jesus, or in Jesus, it is positioned so that we don't know if it goes with God will bring them with Jesus, or through Jesus, because after all, Jesus died, was buried, and resurrected, and he broke the glass ceiling. And if we have his spirit in us, then we will be resurrected to life. Or those who have fallen asleep in Jesus, the idea being that they were converted and in Jesus. Either way, they're both right. So if you want to argue, let's take that somewhere else, some other time. 4, verse 15, this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. This word, asleep. So get it. He's going to come back. And we who are alive will not go before those who are asleep. That is our word for cemetery. So the next time you're driving down the road, which is today, and you see a cemetery, they are sleeping. That's the word. They're sleeping over there. And you think of it, hey, if there's a saint in that cemetery, guess what? That saint, I'm going to watch that saint go and meet the Lord, and then I'm going to join him too. But every time you see a cemetery from now on, remember, they're just sleeping. They're waiting for the Lord to return. Verse 17, then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Gary.
Back to the cemetery.
Yes.
The spirit of the person.
Right.
Right. So where that spirit is, I don't know. it's in the realm of the dead, but it's not actually in that cemetery.
Yes. Thank you. Are you correcting something I said? Are you bringing clarity to something?
Clearing it.
Okay, very good.
It a little bit.
Yep.
You know,
what did I say?
I don't think anything rises from the cemetery. I think it would go from Hades.
Figure speech.
You said something will arise from the cemetery.
That's because that's exactly what I believe. For example, the tombs.
The spirit,
yes, but the body is.
So the body.
For example, like the bodies when Jesus was on the cross.
Yeah.
The bodies came out of the tombs.
Yeah.
I interpret it to be exactly that. We will be caught up into the air, and then our bodies will be transformed, 1 Corinthians 15. That's where I'm going with this. So I might have some technicality off there. May I suggest that we don't get caught up in that right now? Talk to me later. The idea is Christ is coming. And we're going to be with him somehow. Okay? No, I happen to believe that the body will come out of the grave. Could be wrong on that. But Christ is coming, and we will be with him somehow, and we'll be caught up into thee. Therefore, comfort each other with these words. Let's get back to that thought. If you're still wandering, let's not wander for now. We'll wander later. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Hey, guess what? We who are alive and remain, we'll be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we shall always be with the Lord. Who wants to always be with the Lord? I mean, first of all, that introduction sounds pretty exciting to me. Here he comes, trumpets, voice of the archangel, and archangel. Caught up, who wants to fly? I do. With them, with the Lord, and all these other saints. Pretty exciting? Anything more exciting than this? I don't think so. By the way, think of that. Whatever you think is exciting right now, whatever God-given gift that you think is exciting, guess what? This will be more exciting than that. And that's just the beginning of it. The question is, do we comfort each other with these words? We should. We ought to. God is coming. You know, actually, I've been taking this more encouraging one another with these words. And that's true, but this isn't the word. The word is, guess what? It's okay. God is coming. Jesus is coming back. Whatever it is. Whatever it is. You're sad. Jesus is coming back.
I think it's also healthy I know perfect law casts out fear, but I think it's healthy to keep a little bit of that fear in the back of your mind. Because when Jesus comes, he's going to have that two-edged sword coming out of his mouth. It's already pricked our hearts to where we've reacted and lived our lives accordingly. But if you hear that trumpet, you look up, and you see him coming, and your feet are still on the ground, you're going to have, instead of great exaltation, you're going to have great fear at that moment, because that sword is going to come down and start working as a sickle.
And is he going to catch us off guard? In his coming, yes. But in whether or not we're ready for him, will he catch us off guard? No. Because who knows? At least two beings. I know, and God knows. So I got to be ready. I got to be ready. And I know right now. And I don't want to play the lottery with this one. Ah, maybe he'll let me get by. Don't understand the Lord. Do we comfort each other with these words? This is comforting, but only to those who are ready. This is the point that we're making. It's yes, God is coming.
If you have that reaction, you need to examine yourself.
Or if you have the deception, great, but you know, underlying, there's something that you have not repented of.
I think it helps here to try to understand what misconception Paul is trying to correct.
Mm-hmm.
And we're not told directly, but I think we can kind of infer that there was a sense in their part or a fear on their part that if you died before the Lord came back, that was it. You didn't get to go. Mm-hmm. So now the rest of us, you know, better hope you don't die.
Right.
You know, because otherwise you're just stuck.
Right.
And he's putting that
to rest. This is comforting, but only for those who are ready. This is comforting, but only for those who accept the words. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Somebody died. Somebody died. Who wants that? Nobody. Especially if they're an unbeliever. Comfort one another with these words. Hold on, guys. With these words, comfort one another. What if you don't accept the comforting? These are the words. This is God's tool. I want comforting. I want comforting. God, comfort me. Okay. Word, 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 word. No, thank you. I want comforting. I want comforting. Listen. Listen. Don't talk to me yet. This is a poem. Don't talk to me yet. The wound is fresh. The nauseous pain I can't forget fades into numbness like a wave, and then it comes again. Your tears I understand, but grief is dead. It cannot hear the words you gently planned and tried to say. But pray. All right. Yes, there is a time where I'm not processing information right now. I just can't. I cannot process information right now. But the very fix for that is comfort one another with these words. I can't hear what you gently planned to say. You even tried to say it. I can't hear it. You better get over that real fast. Because this is the fix. One more second, guys. I read this a few weeks ago. I'm reading it again. Hemophilia is in a son means great loneliness for a woman. At first, when a hemophilic boy is born, the characteristic maternal reaction is a vigorous resolve to fight. Somehow, somewhere, there must be a specialist who can declare that a mistake has been made or that a cure is just around the corner. One by one, all the specialists are consulted. One by one, they sadly shake their heads. The peculiar emotional security that doctors normally provide when confronting illness is gone, and the mother realizes that she's alone. Having discovered this and accepting it, she begins to prefer it that way. The normal world, going about its everyday life, seems coldly unfeeling. Since the normal world cannot help and does not understand, she prefers to cut herself off from it here, where sadness need not be hidden and there be no questions or pretensions. The inner world becomes the mother's reality. I don't want to hear it. I can't hear it. But this is the very thing you need in this situation. Marcus.
Isn't it with, like, wanting to go to heaven is something that matures the older you get? Because, you know, when I was younger, it's like, I don't want to die now. You know, yes, I'll be ready, but I don't want to die because I want to, you know, get married and have kids. And it's still, you know, looking for your wife. So isn't that like a growing process?
Now he's married. He wants to go to heaven. No commentary on Crystal.
That's a growing process.
Yes. Because being married has given you a taste of what it will be like. Actually, that is more accurate. I'm not saying you said anything inaccurate. I'm saying it's more accurate than what I said just a second ago. Right? Paul says, for to me, to live is Christ, to die is gain. I'm ready to go. I'm ready to go now. And the older we get, that's it.
I'm just remembering a few years ago when our son went to Israel. It was just really bad timing because missiles were being lobbed very many a day into the area that he was sightseeing in. And of course, mom and dad, they're home worried about him. And we contacted him, and he was just having a grand old time. And he just proudly said to us, without a care in the world, I'm not worried, mom and dad, what man can do to me. And it was very comforting for us to know that he had that faith.
Right.
And it became a comfort to us. It's like, yeah, you're right. What are we worrying for?
Yep. Go die. No. But if it happens and he's faithful, well, good for him. Sad for us. Good for him. Somebody else had a hand up sometime? No more hands up. Folks, this is the rapture passage. This is in Matthew 24, but this is really the rapture passage. Premillennialism. What is pre-millennial? What is millennialism? The thousand-year reign of Christ. Pre is he will return before the thousand-year reign. Some think he'll return after it, the thousand-year reign. He will return before the thousand-year reign. And in fact, he'll return before the tribulation. And here we're reading about it, according to them. Oh, he'll come back before the tribulation, and he'll get his saints, his faithful ones, so they don't have to experience the tribulation. That's a pre-trib, pre-millennialist, and there are all sorts of other ones. This is it. This is the passage. Yes?
I've talked to people about the rapture and things like that, and this is the key one, but they also use this one in correlation with Matthew 24, where it says that one will be taken, the other left.
Right.
And they have a field day with that one, too.
Right. So here we are. Rapture passage. Here's the question that this person is answering. What were these Thessalonian Christians worrying about? Which is exactly what John just asked. John's answer is going to sound a whole lot different than this answer. What were they worrying about? They seem not to have been duly informed as to the first resurrection and its relation to the universal one. The dead, they thought, would not return to live till at the general resurrection of the dead after the coming kingdom of Christ on the earth, and would therefore be debarred from the bliss of this kingdom.
Thessalonians have gotten that.
They didn't get this out of reading the text we just did. What? And that's the point. You don't get this from this text. Here's another one. About the word, I love this one. About the word meet, they will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Yes. Now what's going to happen after they meet? The word used for meet is used only three places in the New Testament. In all of them, the party met continues after meeting to advance still in the direction which we was moving previously. The party met is moving this way, in this case, toward the earth from heaven. The party met, the other two times the word is used, or maybe three times, whichever, the party met, after he's been met, continues moving in the same direction. So Jesus is coming to earth.
That's not what it says. They'll meet him in the air and be caught up.
Weak. Go ahead. The rapture. listen, it's supposed to be a secret affair, right? Right. For example, Tim LaHaye is left behind series. This is right off their website. An airborne Boeing 747 is headed to London. Without any warning, passengers mysteriously disappear from their seats. Terror and chaos slowly spread because, you see, after they leave, the world continues in this thought, not only through the plane, but also worldwide, as unusual events continue to unfold. For those who have been left behind, the apocalypse has just begun. It's a mystery to them. It's a secret. They don't know what's happened because they missed the voice of the archangel. Maybe the jet was too loud. I guess that's it. That just came to me. I guess that's what it is. Or the trumpet of God.
How are you going to miss that?
This is not an event anybody's going to miss. Again, my point is, this is not in the text. And that's all I'm going to say about it.
I guess you don't want your pilot and co-pilot to be Christians.
That's right. I want my pilot to be a Christian.
I know. Thank you.
All right. Any other comments or questions? Some were teaching, if you read the New Testament, within a few years after Christ's resurrection, there would be no resurrection. That's 1 Corinthians 15. The resurrection had already occurred. That's 2 Timothy. We haven't got there yet. And 2 Thessalonians. There would be a resurrection, but some of the faithful might not make it. So I guess just about any doctrine can be twisted anyway, can't it? So, what is our guard against that? I know.
Stick to this.
Yes. Stick to this.
Study to show yourself approved.
Study. 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 We had better know the word so we can recognize when it has been twisted. When is the best time to figure out some passage? After you're encountering the twisting or before? Now, sometimes that goes hand in hand. I recognize that. But generally speaking, you want to know this text already so that when you go out into the fight, you can identify, oh, is that twisting or not? Wham! You're dead. Nobody wants that. Ephesians chapter 4. He gave some as apostles, some as evangelists, verse 11. Ephesians 4, verse 11. He gave some as apostles, some as prophets, some as evangelists, and some as pastors and teachers. For, by the way, all of them have to do with the word. They all deliver the word. Some of them can do miracles, other ones not necessarily. A pastor and a teacher, not necessarily. But they all deliver the word. This is word-centric. Why? For the equipping of the saints for the work of service to the building up of the body of Christ until we all attain to the unity of faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, to a mature man, to the measure which of the stature which belongs to the fullness of Christ. As a result, we are no longer to be children tossed here and there by waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by trickery of men, by craftiness and deceit and scheming, so on and so forth. It goes on to say, love each other. But in between there is, hey, we've got to study this word so that we're not carried around by every wind of doctrine, by the trickery of men and the craftiness of deceitful scheming. Study, study, study the word. Are we all on the same page here? Did you notice that it said that there will be some who are teachers? Generally speaking, a teacher implies, say it again.
A student.
A student. We would call a group of students a
class.
Do you think the teachers had classes? And you can even broaden that to be somewhat loose. Did the teachers have classes? Did the teachers have groups of students? Did the teacher have one student? If there's a teacher, there's a student. Is there anything, do you think, that would limit the teacher from teaching on Sunday? No, you may not teach on Sunday.
Well, the apostles taught on Sunday, and they were teachers.
In fact, Paul will call himself an apostle and a teacher, distinguishing the two. I am not only an apostle, I'm a teacher. Right. Let's ask it another way. Is there any day of the week that you would not permit a teacher to teach so that the result would be we are no longer to be children tossed here and there by every wind of wave and carried around by every wind of doctrine, trickery of men, by craftiness and deceitful scheming? No. No, I want that 24/7. Right? The idea is, look, folks, if you can get a class together, get one together. Well, what day is it? It's the day to get a class together. Comment or question? So we've got 7 minutes left. We'll pop on over to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Now, continuing the same topic, but he's going to get more practical. Now, as to the times and the epochs, epochs, seasons, the first word is chronology. Or if you've seen whoever it is, The Incredibles, Chronos. Time marching on. Tick, 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 tick. You cannot stop time. It marches on. The second word has to do with a specific season. These circumstances characterize this time. For example, right now it is the quote-unquote Easter season. Okay? So, about time ticking on until it stops, you don't know. About the season, you won't be able to look at the season and say, oh, here it comes. You have no need of anyone, of anything to be written to you. For, here's why, you yourselves know full well that the day of the Lord will come just like a thief in the night. Verse 3, the circumstances the world will be in when the Christ returns. Listen to this. While they are saying peace and safety, then destruction will come upon them suddenly like labor pains upon a woman with a child, and they will not escape. That they will not escape is the point. The pain of the child labor here is not so much the point, although that's there. The point is, when labor comes, you don't avoid it. You can't. It comes. And that's it. We've all witnessed that. When the day of the Lord comes, they will not, emphatic, they will not be able to avoid it. It will come. They're saying peace and safety. This is the word that in Acts chapter 5, when the apostles have all been locked up, it might be 4, but 4 or 5, when the apostles have been all locked up, and then the Holy Spirit comes at night, or the angel of the Lord comes at night and sets them free. And then the next morning, the Sanhedrin says, go guards, get them. And the guards come back and say, they're not there. The house was locked. There's the word. The house was locked. They shouldn't have been able to get out. They shouldn't be able to get in. Peace and safety. We are fine. Nothing can happen to us. Oh. So this is interesting. I'm not so convinced that the sign, I don't think I'll be able to judge it anyway, but the sign is, look at the terrible times. Yeah, times are terrible. But when times get so terrible that people are saying, we are perfectly fine. Whew. That's not a good time to be hanging around. Okay, but, verse 4, now the circumstances Christians will not be in. When the first is, the circumstance the world will be in. The second is, the circumstances Christians will not be in. Verse 4, but you, as opposed to the world in verse 3, but you, brethren, are not in darkness, that the day would overtake you like a thief in the night. Christians are unaware of the time, but not unexpected of the event. We know it's going to happen. We just don't know when. They don't know it's going to happen. And they don't know when. We know it will happen. We've made this point before. Oh, this is a new one. The result. Brethren, you are not in darkness, and here's the result. That the day would overtake you. The day is coming. It will overtake all of those who are in the darkness. If you do not want the day to overtake you, then you must get into the light, and it'll work. That is the plan. Just get in the light. That's all you got to do. I don't want the day to overtake me. Okay, get in the light. That's the result. The reward, John Edward might think I'm picking on him, but it actually impacts or emphasizes how much his little lesson had an impact on me. He said, why should we believe the Lord? Not meaning what are the evidences for believing the Lord, but what is the reward? What benefit is there for reward? Yeah, here's a benefit. When the day of the Lord comes, I'm not going to get caught up in it. Well, maybe I will get caught up in it. Right? Matthew 24. Let's turn there. We referred to it before, and then I'll be done for today. Maybe somebody else has a good point to make. Matthew 24. Verse 36, of that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, but the Father alone, nor the Son, but the Father alone. For the coming of the Son of Man will be just like the days of Noah. Listen to this. For as in the days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage. The idea is they were saying, peace and safety, peace and safety. Until the day Noah entered the ark. And they did not understand until the flood came and took them all away. So will be the coming of the Son of Man. There will be two men in the field. One will be taken and one will be left. Two women will be grinding. One will be taken, one will be left. So put yourself back there. You're in Noah's day. And here comes the rain. What are you doing surrounding that boat? You're pounding on the door. I want in. I want in. Until you drown. Who wants that? Anybody for a little drowning action today? No, I don't want that. The reward of being faithful is two-part, as Marcus is pointing out. It's two-part. I'm not going to have to endure the day of the Lord and His wrath. That's one reward, and the other reward is I get to be with Him. Encourage each other with these words. Comments or questions from anybody? John.
I'm just opening up something for you. Okay. Now, the key back then with Noah, who sealed the door? God sealed the door. Mm-hmm. So even if Noah could have, at that point, judgment could have occurred for the earth. We will have that same point at that point where God seals again.
That's right.
And at that point it's too late.
Yeah. It would be one judgment. Good point. Thank you for your work. We'll break till right on the hour.